And good morning to everyone. Deviating slightly from the other topics, I am here to give you some inputs or insights on forensics. So when you say forensic, it is something relating to forum or court or jury procedures. So what I am trying to cover in about next about 20 minutes is digital forensics, challenges posed by the new age technology cloud to forensic community on investigating and finding out what are some of the deviations that has happened, etc. And a concept called forensic readiness, which I know many of you would be getting into startups, owning your own servers and other IT resources in cloud. And unless you are ready to prepare a better roadmap, how regulatory agencies are going to come on to you for some of the mandatory requirements. So let us start with digital forensics, something very, very simple. It is one of the youngest branches of forensic science. And I think somewhere in the, towards the end of 80s, somewhere 88, 89, and early 90s, this branch really started opening up. I remember the first case, some of you might have heard about the Purulia arms drop case. So we had literally no forensic tools even. And I got a laptop of the pilot of that aircraft that dropped illegal arms across Purulia. And only some common sense worked. We did not have many operating systems, just something like DOS-operated computer it was. So ultimately, one undelete command worked. Some of you might have used DOS, you would understand that there is an undelete command. And it helped recovering almost about thousands of documents, more than 1,000 documents, by just one undelete command. So today it is quite different. It is dealing with very advanced methodologies to preserve, recover, and document electronics evidence in a manner acceptable as evidence in a court of law. Now, to tell or define it in a slightly broader language, it is discovering, acquiring, preserving, analyzing, and presenting evidence in a court of law. So I'll elaborate each one of these slightly more. When I say discovering, many of you would have been are using two-wheelers and four-wheelers. It gets into some or other issues. You might have gone to some mechanics. The moment you explain the situation, they immediately go and pinpoint the location where the issue is. You get to some novice guys, they may do all each and everything. They say your engine has to be changed. So that type of thing. So when I say discovering, the moment you have a scenario where some issue has happened, some incident has happened, discovering means knowing where to look for evidence. Should have complete knowledge of the architecture of the system, should understand the applications, should know all other things that are coming in place to understand where could be the potential evidence relating to this incident would be possible. Then acquiring. Acquiring is actually you are physically trying to collect the container of the evidence, or in some cases the evidence itself, because when I say container of evidence, it could be a hard disk, some sort of SAN or storage area network, etc. So in some cases it may be possible to be picked up because the items are in India or within the geographical jurisdiction of India, or some cases it would be outside India where you may not be able to even touch that. We are coming to challenges subsequently. And then preserving is, we are coming explaining more this in detail next one. You need to actually keep a forensic copy so that you are not actually tampering while analyzing it in the next stage. And then preparing a report and presenting it before the jury in a manner which is clearly understood by the judge. You know, the judge may not be a technical guy. If you give a technically strong report, he may not understand. And the legal system in our country is always favoring the innocent. And what they say, even if 1,000 accused escape, one innocent should not be punished. And most of the accused, because of this particular axiom, what they try to do is try to create some confusion in the mind of jury, so that rather than going giving a hard punishment, if the confusion regarding the whole process is created in the mind of jury, they say, because I have not understood it, so I think he may or may not be an innocent, so let me not punish him. So all these phases are quite important. And we are coming to different forensic methodology and procedure. So today, if you see, except for certain procedures that are not very up to date. The forensic procedures use very reliable and systematic tool sets, procedures, and the whole thing is covered into acquisition, preservation, analysis, and presentation. These are all the four different phases in a forensic analysis. So when you say acquisition, as I was covering in the previous one, you identify what is the evidence available, where it is lying, and try and acquire that container. So in all the investigations, there is a thing called chain of custody. That means you collect an evidence, the investigating agency is supposed to be documenting it, and that particular document is called chain of custody. So the chain of custody tracks the movement of evidence from location of collection till it is presented in a court of law. The purpose is to see that no one is tampering it. So acquisition is the initiating process, then preservation. Unless conventional cases, I can give an example, like there is a dead body maybe somewhere lying, and there are some blood-stained clothes lying, maybe it can be assumed that it might be that of an attacker. In a conventional case, an investigator can take a piece of that blood-stained cloth and send it to forensic lab for analysis. But in digital evidence, you cannot cut a piece of hard disk and send it to analysis. So there has to be some methodology by which the suspect media has to be cloned in a forensically sound manner, and it is not challenged anywhere in the whole process. That particular thing is called preservation. So what is actually done is, if you come across something, if you have a suspect disk that is forensically cloned, so that sector zero to sector last is picked up the way it is there in the original, and there are some test procedures to cross-check and validate all these, yes, the one which is now available, all the evidences or all the contents of the acquired disk is same as that of the suspect disk. So there are certain procedures, etc. So why it is being done is that, unlike in conventional case, we cannot first of all make pieces of evidence. Then you are analyzing the things in a digital environment, which is very, very prone to changes, even with a small mistakes, or I'll not say mistake, even some of the external influences which cannot be in the control of the analyst. So analyst, the moment if he has to work on the original, he'll be always under constant fear whether I'll be tampering with this or not, etc. So original is always preserved, and in the forensic labs, the analyst is working only on the copies. And even the court may, as per the legal procedures of different courts of world all across, the court may always want the original. Like in conventional case, you have a sample of the actual content is available. Here, if you start working on the original, then it is no more an original. So court may ask for reviews, like, okay, where is the original? Prepare one more copy of that, give it to another expert, and see if that expert is also coming with the same opinion or not. So that is the purpose of preservation. Then analysis. Analysis is actually a detailed examinations, mainly to find out what all the evidence links available, interpret as to what happened, and who or what was accountable for a particular action. This is what happens in the analysis stage. It also creates a report, so that the report is no more a technical stuff. It will be in a very simple, plain language, so that the jury will be able to understand it. Now, when it is presented before a court, how a court decides whether it will be an appropriate report or not, it depends upon the type of standards that are used, the qualification and experience of the one who analyzed it, presented it, etc. And it has to be always something like logical. So the report is always created in such a manner, it is easily understood and presented in a manner that is seen as logical and something very that can be accepted easily. Now we'll come to challenges. So I have given you a very brief or basic introduction about digital forensics. Now the onset of cloud, that brought in a lot of challenges. So the traditionally, what was the belief for an investigator or a law enforcement agency is that if somebody has a crime, technology crime, he has used a computer, laptop or mobile, there is a physical device associated with that crime. That device can be picked up. It can be it can be processed for further analysis, and all the deleted documents, everything can be recovered, and it can be presented in a court of law. Now comes the thing of cloud. Now in cloud, what is happening? It may or may not be within the jurisdiction of India, So starting that onwards, we have a lot of challenges. Let us start by one. And before getting into that, let me just show you. By cloud, you have three different services. Something like infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. What you see in blue color is in your control in each of these situations as a customer. So for example, if you're going infrastructure as a service, you have some control on the application logs or other time logs available. So only that is available, but then many of the other things, right from networking, storage, servers, everything is in the control of service provider. When you go into platform as a service, you have only application and database and associated logs. And when you go software as a service, this is the model many of the people operate, you have nothing in your control. So if a law enforcement action comes and they knock on your door, you will be required to provide logs of different thing. And they say, no, I have no logs. Then you will be actually violating certain terms and conditions of Section 43 of IT Act. So we'll come to that in the next slide. So these are all some of the things we'll go one by one. The first and second point we'll take together. The growing volumes and extended timelines. So for example, growing data volumes. I remember the first computer on which I started did not have even a hard disk. We used to use one floppy disk to boot it, another floppy disk to start an application, another floppy disk to store the data. And even today, I remember the first hard disk that I used was 40 MB. And I was thinking, what will I do with this 40 MB? It's so huge. But today, it has come to a situation that even 5 TB hard disk, if it is coming, it gets filled up. And because we are operating in clouds, most of the data is getting into the clouds, 2 TB, 10 TB. It gets into that stage. But when a forensic action is required, what is happening is you do not have physical access to it. It is in some other jurisdiction. The type of connectivity that with which we have, if we try to download data from the servers, it may take days and weeks together for collecting the evidence itself. And the forensic procedures need everything to come in one go. There is something called a hashing procedure, it's a test procedure for forensic purpose. But many times it gets disconnected, you'll have to start from the beginning again. I had seen many such situations I myself have come across where you start downloading it, it completed fourth day, maybe another 5% is left, internet got disconnected. You'll have to again start it. Then jurisdictional challenges, forget about other countries. Even in India, the procedures between one court in one state is different from another court in many, many situations. So that's another challenge. Availability of logs versus detection of crimes. Many of you who had been interested or who are interested in investigation, etc., would have somewhere read that many schools of criminology has come out with findings after research that a crime is detected, an average time for detection of a crime is anything between 18 to 36 months. That means this crime would have been happening, but it is detected after so many days. You take any major frauds, it is like that. In India, as per the rules, the duration for maintaining of logs is 90 days. 30 days, 60 days, 90 days. Whereas the crime itself is detected after 18 months, means you don't have anything pertaining to that to find out. Then, authorization to access data. A court, say for example, as an investigator, I'll submit to a court of law for a warrant, etc. Court, and if the server in question or the hard disk in question is in outside India, our court has no jurisdiction at all. Hence, there is no question of you seizing anything because it is outside jurisdiction. We have no power at all. Getting into the next one, authenticity and chain of custody. Traditionally, you could seize a computer and start the chain of custody. Here, you cannot even seize it because it is somewhere else. Recovery of deleted data doesn't happen at all because you do not have the device with you. Then there are certain things like I have come across some criminals. So the criminals understand all these very easily. He has application in one server. He has mail server in another one, data storage in another, all three different countries. So that if one country cooperate, the other country will not cooperate. Then all these things operate in different time zones. So when you have, as per Indian time, IST, you might have sent something at 11:45. The same thing in US would be in some other different time zone. So when you collate and collect all the evidence, it really confuses the jury. Like here, if someone wants to, sir or my owner, this is 10 a.m. and here he is shown as 10 p.m. how it can happen, because by the time the concept of time zone, all these things, unless you are very, very properly documenting it and presenting it to the jury, they'll say, yeah, everything is confused, so I will not better, I will rather let this guy go acquitted rather than punishing, because I do not know whether I myself is not very convinced about the things. Then you have virtual machine environment, metadata, log formats, and last but not the least, NIST, the US-based organization that develops standards, has not yet finalized standards for computer forensics because it has about 65 questions for which there is no answer as on date. So that is the that are the some of the major challenges that pose. Now I will end my session with something called computer forensic readiness. So when I say computer forensic readiness, it is the capacity and preparedness of an organization to respond to incidents that is likely to happen in future. Because with all these challenges, law enforcement will expect you to follow the procedures as per Section 43 of IT Act. What Section 43 says? That you should have reasonable security practices within you before you start anything. And if I start an investigation as a law enforcement agency, I should get all the logs and everything available. But because your stuffs are all in server domain, and you have not entered into an agreement with that service provider in the cloud that my logs should be recorded, kept for 1 year, 2 years, etc., it is going to be a big challenge when such a law enforcement action that is likely to come up. So what my concluding remarks is that, like, keeping all these, when you start a cloud service or when you opt for a cloud service, you also should understand the complexities of IT Act and the necessity for maintaining the Section 43 demands of Section 43, by which you should be prepared to, you should have reasonable safety security practices and incorporate all those so that in future if there is a law enforcement action, you should be able to respond to it. And with that, I am coming to a conclusion. Thank you, thanks a lot, and it was a great honor to speak in the first edition of TEDxIIIT Bangalore. Thanks a lot.